Let's talk about heat. So, oftentimes, you will find a lot of confusion about the concept of heat and temperature. Okay, so there are two different things. So let's talk about heat in general. Well, what is it? Before you can really understand heat, we got to kind of first lay down a couple concepts about the nature of matter in general. So, let's talk about particle theory first. Notice it's particle theory and not particle fact. We'll talk about why that is shortly. Particle theory says that all matter is made up of small particles. And I know I'm being purposely vague with that because small particles end kind of where it's convenient for you on your level of study. So when we say small particles, we could mean like molecules. Maybe we mean atoms. I don't know. And, in other parts of physics, we might even want to go smaller than atoms, right? We might want to go to subatomic particles, like protons and neutrons, or we might even want to go smaller than that into the realm of quarks. But really, this is kind of going to be good enough for an understanding of heat at the level that we're going to be working at. Okay, so all matter is made up of small particles. So then I might ask you, well, how do we define matter? What is matter? And the old definition, the classic definition, I guess, is this is something that has mass and takes up space. So that's what matter is. And then you're going to say, well, what's mass? And you start to get going down a little bit of a rabbit hole here. But a definition of mass could be something that resists changes to its motion, which we would call, I guess, inertial mass, right? Because inertia is the resistance to change in motion that is a property of mass. Or you can also talk about it in terms of gravity or something that gravity acts on. All right? And if you look over at the periodic table, right, you'll see a whole bunch of the basic atomic building blocks of matter. Okay, so look to the periodic table to find all the different types of atoms that are readily available to build other matter from. Right, so we take those atoms and we build molecules or ionic compounds, the case may be. But that is sort of your organizational table of available matter in the universe. Okay, so small particles. So now we want to talk about heat. So let's imagine that we have like a jar of particles. I'm going to make a square jar though. A chamber. This is a chamber of particles. Johnson's chamber of particles. Okay. So imagine the inside of this is filled with particles. Oh, they're not squares though. We'll make them dots. And we're going to talk about the concept of heat in terms of the particles inside this chamber. Okay, so there they are. So further to particle theory, we could talk about the fact that particles can be in three phases, right? So there's three phases that matter can be found in. So it can either be gas, it can be liquid, it can be solid. So thinking particle-wise, let's talk about gases first. And let's imagine that we have a really like a really light well, we'll talk about a noble gas. Let's talk about helium. Let's say these are helium particles. Okay, so if I think about helium, it's got two protons and two neutrons inside it. It's got two electrons kind of filling this first shell. It has very little affinity or attraction to other helium particles. Okay, so when we talk about an ideal gas, which we will in a little bit, let's imagine that this is nearly an ideal gas. So that would mean in gas phase, helium has no attraction to other helium particles. Okay, it has freedom of movement. Each particle has freedom of movement. throughout this, you know, chamber can move wherever. The motion of the particles is random. They're not all moving in the same direction, right? So if I pick a particular particle, it's really just sort of random chance which direction it's moving in. And the velocities of the particles are normally distributed. So I'll talk about what that means in a second. Velocities of particles are normally distributed. Actually, it's not quite true. Not normally distributed. Let me just fix that. Say are distributed for now, because it's a special kind of distribution. Let's say Boltzmann. Distribution, just kind of like a normal curve, but not quite. All right, so there we go. So you imagine this chamber, it's gas. These particles are all like zipping around. They're colliding and bouncing off of each other, right? And just moving around inside of here. So let's talk about, you know, what would happen with this chamber in general. So let's say I put like a pressure gauge on here, right? And inside the pressure gauge, it's got a membrane, right? So it's going to read some value in terms of pressure. We measure pressure in pascals. So if you don't know what a pascal is, I'll just give you a quick tutorial on a pascal. So imagine that we have a 1 meter square on the ground, say. And if we put 1 newton of force equally distributed over this square meter, we have 1 pascal of pressure. So 1 PA is equal then to 1 newton per square meter, 1 newton per square meter, so you know. So what is this thing actually telling us? Well, as these particles smash into the sensor, right, they exert like a small amount of force on it, right? They're you know, hammering into this thing, and they're actually hammering to the walls of this chamber, and this is able to detect that and read it as pressure. Okay, so now what happens if I add some heat to this chamber? So let's get some heat, get a little fire under it, logs, look at that, eh? A little campfire. So we know a little bit about energy, right? We know that there is some chemical energy inside this wood, and that heat is coming out of that wood. And basically, you know, essentially what's going on here is we've got some type of hydrocarbon plus oxygen, we got CO2, we got H2O, and we've got heat coming out of it, right? It's classic sort of combustion reaction, all right? That energy was locked away in the chemical bonds of this hydrocarbon, all right? In the most, you know, in the case of logs anyway, that energy originally came from the sun in the form of photosynthesis, right? To create glucose molecules that then got, you know, turned into, what they get turned into, the fibers of the wood. Help me out, I can't remember the name of it. What are wood fibers called? Cellulose, yes, cellulose and starch. Oh, there it is. It's there somewhere. Cellulose and starch. Okay, so that energy then is getting released. When I see fire, I might be tempted to say, well, like, what am I actually seeing? Like, what is the fire? So what the fire is actually is hot gas, right? So that's the CO2 and the H2O coming off there. And they're so hot that they're actually like emitting sort of like essentially radiation in the visible spectrum, as well as in the infrared and in other spectrums. And later we'll talk about black body radiation and why things glow when they're hot. But that's what a fire is, right? It's superheated gas that's glowing. So when you see fire, that's what you're seeing. Now, some of that heat is going to go into this chamber, right? Or so I should say, not some of that heat, some of that energy is going to go into the chamber. And that energy will be passed into these particles, all right? So if we imagine that the bottom of this chamber gets hot, right, it heats up. Well, what's going on there is the atoms in that metal are starting to jiggle faster. They're obtaining from the heat extra velocity on their velocity, or extra speed onto their travel, okay? And when particles from inside here come in contact with that, they actually can bounce off with a slightly higher velocity than they came in with. So over time, as heat travels in, what's actually happening is the velocities of these particles are increasing. So in other words, the kinetic energy of the particles inside here are increasing, right? That's 1/2 mv². Now let's say you stick your hand in here and it's full of hot gas. Well, you're going to get burnt. The question is, why do you get burnt? Well, you get burnt because if this particle collides with the particles in your hand, it can transfer some of that energy. You know, we know about momentum, the momentum of collisions. If this particle crashes into your hand and loses some of its momentum, well, then that same momentum gets gained by the particles in your hand. They therefore increase their velocity and start to jiggle faster and faster and faster. And if they're going fast enough, you get a burn, right? It maybe boils the water in your skin, causing cell damage and so on. So at the end of the day, what we know as heat is really the kinetic energy in particles inside objects. Now we're talking about just a gas here, but the same applies for liquids and solids, right? As we add heat to liquids, their particles jiggle faster and faster and faster until, of course, they go to a phase change. We'll talk about that a little bit later. Or if they're solid, right, they melt, right? So if they're liquid, they'll get to a certain temperature and then they'll turn into a gas and continue to heat. Solids will, you know, jiggle, jiggle, jiggle until they get to a certain point, they'll phase change into a liquid and so on. But the general concept behind this is that what we know as heat, okay, what we feel as heat is actually just the kinetic energy of particles being higher or lower, all right? So we take energy from one source and we turn it into the kinetic energy of particles somewhere else. Conservation of energy laws say no heat that's in here is ever lost to the environment, okay? But during transfers, it goes into the environment, but it's never lost from the universe, right? It just gets transferred into another form. And we also can understand that pressure is tied into that. If these particles are hitting faster, we're going to register a higher pressure inside the box. They're hitting the walls more often, right? So when heat goes up, pressure goes up if volume is kept the same, all right? You can talk about what happens when you change volume in just a minute here, but that's the general concept behind heat. Something that's hotter has particles that are moving faster, assuming that it's the same substance, all right? Now let's talk about temperature. So temperature is measured via an instrument called a thermometer. So let's imagine that we take this hot chamber and we put a thermometer inside it. Think about what is going to happen here. So I'm going to draw a little thermometer. Okay, so there's a thermometer. And inside a thermometer, there's usually some alcohol or mercury, depending on how good your thermometer is. And this is how you create a thermometer. Let's talk about how you create one. Actually, sorry, let's talk about how it works, then we'll talk about how you create one. So you stick that in there, and what will happen is the particles from here will randomly smash into there, right? And they might transfer a bit of their energy into the liquid inside the thermometer, whose particles will then start to jiggle. And as things jiggle, they tend to attempt to take up more space. So if this is liquid inside here, as this liquid heats up, right, it takes up more space and it moves up the thermometer. Okay, the reverse might be true. Let's say instead of having a fire down here, we put ice down here. Well, then as the particles hit the walls, they'll lose a bit of their energy to the walls and they'll slowly over time cool down. And what will happen is the high speed particles from inside the thermometer will pass the energy into the chamber. Okay, and slowly this will decrease as heat gets lost to the environment and lost inside here. So that's how a thermometer works. Something that's interesting about heat is this. Heat is always transferred from a hot object to a cold object, never the other way around. Why should this be so? It's just one of those laws of the universe. I mean, I don't know if I've ever heard a really strong explanation as to why hot always flows to cold. So in other words, if I put two objects, right next to each other, and let's say I insulate them. So in other words, I then take these two things, I put them into a really well insulated like cooler, okay, or I put insulation around them or whatever. I lock them in there and I wait for a couple of hours. When I come back, what will have happened is heat from this object will have flowed into this. Okay, so remember what's going on here is this is hot, and they might be the same thing. These could both be like blocks of iron, right? These particles were moving much faster. Okay, they're in contact with the object next to them. So when these hit the wall, they lose a little bit of their energy to these, which then gain that energy and speed up a little bit. So after some amount of time, we will have this go on. I'm gonna draw a little graph here. We'll talk about the thermometer in a minute. I haven't forgotten about it. But we'll have this little graph here. And let's say we have, sorry, just draw the bottom. So this will be time on the bottom axis, and this will be temperature on the y-axis. Okay, so let's say we have temp and time. Okay, so we've got a hot object here, and we've got a cold object down here somewhere. And this is the way that nature works, right? We'll lose temperature from the hot object, and we will gain temperature in the cold object. What you will never see is that this object gets colder while this one gets hotter, all right? It's statistically not completely impossible. It just doesn't happen in nature. Okay, so that hopefully gives you a sense of the concept of what heat is, right? Heat, you could say, is it is the measure, or what we feel is heat, is the kinetic energy of the particles of a substance. If those particles have more kinetic energy and they're moving faster, we sense that with our, you know, with our bodies and our skin and our instruments as being hotter. Interesting things happen with hot objects, such as, for instance, as they get hotter and hotter, they might start to glow. So what that is hot objects actually radiate energy, electromagnetic energy, out into the environment. And we'll talk about that later. That's black body radiation. It's kind of an interesting sideline to all this. That's for future story about, though. Okay, so the kinetic energy of particles is higher in hot objects than in cold objects. As time passes, right, objects at different temperatures come to an equilibrium. They come to the same temperature as time passes. You know this, right? You take a drink out of the fridge, you put it on the counter, and you come back in a couple of hours, it'll be at room temperature, right? Interestingly, that little cup will have lowered the temperature of your room just a little bit, assuming your house is sealed, right? There's always interactions between your house and the environment and so on. But in principle, that's kind of true. So let's talk about a thermometer, and let's talk about the impossibility of exactly measuring a temperature. Not the impossibility, but just, I guess, how it works. So let's say, we'll talk about Celsius first, because it's kind of interesting. It's sort of the basis of, our temperature system, at least in Canada. There's also the Fahrenheit system, which I don't really understand all that well. I sort of do, but not really. Let's imagine that we have in here a block of ice, okay? And let's say it's like, let's not even do it that way. Let's just do it this way. Let's say we have liquid water in here, okay? No, let's say we have ice water in here. That's a better way. Okay, so we have ice water, all right? Okay. So what that means is the ice and the water are at the same temperature. So we're going through a phase change. We'll do an experiment with phase change in a bit, in a few days, so you get a better sense of this. What you might know is that during a phase change, like when ice is turning to water, for instance, that it holds the same temperature, okay? So we know that that happens at 0 degrees Celsius. So I can draw a proper thermometer. So let's imagine we put that in there. This. That there. This little cap on the top. Okay, so we've got inside the thermometer a really thin tube, right? There's a little thin tube inside there. And inside that, we'll put some mercury. Okay, so a little bit of mercury inside here. So let's draw that. And that mercury is pooled down at the bottom right here. Say it rises to right here. Okay, so now what we start to do is we add some heat, okay? So we start to allow this to heat up. And while the ice is melting, it'll just stay in the same spot. So actually what we'll do is we'll put a little like mark on our thermometer. We'll scratch it right there, okay? Then the ice will melt, right? Melty, melty, melty. And suddenly the temperature will start to rise. So if we were graphing this, we would see something like this. Okay, so this is the readings from our thermometer. What we'd see is we'd see it hold temp for a while. Then we'd see it start to rise. And then we'd see it hold temp again. Okay? So this mercury in here starts to go up higher and higher and higher and higher and higher and higher and higher. And then it stops again. Okay? And when it stops, at that point, we notice that the water has started to boil. So we take our thermometer and we draw another scratch on it. Okay? So the Celsius system works by designating this, where we have water turning from ice to liquid. We call that 0 degrees Celsius. And we designate where water boils to be 100 degrees Celsius. So then what we would do is we would just measure, and this has to go up linearly. So in a really good thermometer, it goes up perfectly linearly. In other words, this tube inside of here is perfect, all right? And we go halfway and we mark that as 50. Half that again, mark those as 75 and 25. And before long, you've got this like sorted out into 100 degradations, 100 degrees, all right? And that really is the basis of our temperature system, okay? You can continue down below here, right? You can get below zero and you can get above 100 degrees, okay? And you know, that can just essentially go on forever until the water turns into like a plasma. But at this point, we say it's steam. Right at this point, we say it's water. And back over here, we would have said it was ice. Okay, we've called this 0 degrees Celsius. We've called this 100 degrees Celsius. So that's how the Celsius system is defined. Okay, so you just keep on going on up and you keep on going on down, and there you go. All right, now why was it designated as 100 degrees between that and that? It's just by definition, by choice. I mean, it's a sort of a metric idea that you base it on tens. Precision-wise, I guess 100 was seen as good enough, or I mean, I think it's pretty precise. Go between 0 and 100, that's a fairly, you know, 1 or 2 degrees is almost unnoticeable, I guess, what I'm trying to say. Yeah. Now let's talk about the other temperature system, the more official metric one. Okay, so do that a little bit different. We'll talk about that with a chamber of helium. So water's an interesting substance, right? But maybe it's not the best thing to base a measurement system on, right? It's kind of arbitrary in a sense. I mean, you can say that about the whole metric system. It's all based on stuff to do with water originally, at least the mass part anyway. Yeah, like there's got to be a better way, right? Does this actually have any tie-in with nature, I guess is what I'm asking. And the answer is no, not really. I mean, there just happens to be a lot of water around on Earth, so it's sort of a natural thing for humans to like base stuff on. We have a lot of experience with water. A more modern temperature system is the Kelvin scale, which you might know about. And the Kelvin scale actually uses degrees from the Celsius scale. Okay? So the distance between 2 degrees, 1 degree, and 2 degree is the same in Celsius and Kelvin. So how far apart they are is the same. But where they're set is different. Okay? So let's imagine then we have a chamber, but inside this chamber, we have an ideal gas. Okay? And we have a gas that has no attraction to other gas particles whatsoever. Remember, water's weird, right? It's very polar, and it does some strange things, right? It's got a high attraction for other water molecules, and there's some interesting things that go on there. So it's not a good thing to base a universal temperature system on, okay? But if we take helium, or if you want, maybe even just take like a theoretical perfect gas, okay? That has zero attraction to other gas particles. Okay. Well, what will happen is you have to get this stuff very cold before it'll actually coalesce into liquids and then solids, right? So, this is what you do. You fill your chamber with helium. And it might not be even be helium. I'm just using helium as an example because it would be maybe one of the particles with the least likelihood of attracting other particles, right? There's no, there would be no like polar bonds here. There'd be no dipole bonds, and there'd be no momentary dipole bond, no van der Waals or very low van der Waals forces, right? The larger the molecule, even if it is symmetrical and nonpolar, the van der Waals forces will cause attraction between them. So if you imagine that there's no attraction between this, I think the best you could probably do with real gas is helium. So there is some level of theoreticalness to this. So this is what you do. You take this, and you take a Celsius thermometer that's really long, right? And you start to decrease the temperature inside this tube. And here's what you'll find. Here's what you'll find. If you graph this, we'll get something that looks like, where are we here? Make a little graph. And then the other thing that we're going to do here is we're going to test pressure. I'm going to put a pressure tester on here. Okay, as we do this, okay, put pressure on this one. We're going to set this as 0 degrees Celsius. Okay, so this is temp in degrees Celsius. This measures the pressure of the gas. You'll find that there's a linear relationship, right, as you would expect, between these two things. And you can get this, like, pretty cold, but you can't get it, like, ridiculously cold. There's a cutoff to how cold you can get this, but you can get it pretty cold. But if you extend this line, right, if you find, you know, you take a bunch of data points along this line, you measure pressure, right, here's all your data points along here, and you make a line of best fit, you will find that you're going to cross here. In other words, pressure will reach 0 pascals. Right here. And this happens to be at negative 273 degrees Celsius. So the theoretical intercept here of the x-axis, so where pressure gets to zero, happens at negative 273. So what's going on inside the chamber at that point? Well, we've cooled these down so much, they've all kind of settled out and they've stopped moving. All right? So in other words, there's no particles left to bump into this and give it any pressure, okay? Theoretically, what has happened is they've stopped moving. They've had all the kinetic energy removed from them. So they're in a solid clump sitting at the bottom, not moving at all, okay? Beyond that, the concept of temperature makes no sense, right? There is no temperature if the particles aren't moving, because what temperature is really measuring is the kinetic energy of the particles in here as they smash into it. Okay. Another way to do this, I guess, would be to keep a constant pressure and have a flexible chamber that shrinks, right? So like take a balloon, for instance, as you cool it down, it shrinks, right? The walls cave in as pressure drops. But I mean, really what you're talking about is a drop in pressure. Okay. So this is now going to be redefined as a new zero point. And we call that 0K. So what that then does is it says, okay, well, where I was at 0 degrees Celsius is now 273 up the scale. There is no such thing as negative values on the Kelvin scale, right? Because it doesn't make sense, because it starts at zero and just goes up from there to however high a temperature you can imagine. Okay, does that make sense? So that's where the Kelvin temperature scale comes. The degradations in it, though, are the same width as Celsius degradations. Okay, Celsius came first, so in a way it's, I don't know if degradations is the right word. It doesn't seem like the right word. Demarcations? I don't know, marks, okay, distances. So 1 degree on Kelvin is equal to 1 degree distance in Celsius, but where the scale is set is separate. Okay, just a couple more things before we wrap up. I wanna remind you about the mole. Okay, and this is how matter is quantified. Okay, so if I take, I can't use black here, but if I take a hunk of carbon, can you guys see that color, or is it too, I'll use this one. There, okay, imagine this is a block of carbon, okay? It's useful for chemists and physicists to know how many particles there are in a given block of carbon, right? How many carbon atoms there are in there. So what you do is you realize first that carbon-12 has 6 protons and 6 neutrons in it. It's also got a few electrons around the outside. But you know what? They're so small, we can kind of safely like just ignore them, right? They're only 1/2000th of the mass of a proton or a neutron. So they make up very, very little of the overall mass of any block, right? And then what you do is you say, okay, this is all made of that carbon-12. Okay, the whole thing is carbon-12 atoms. And if we measure very precisely exactly 12 grams of this, and then we use clever counting, we can figure out exactly how many atoms there are inside of here. So in 12 grams, exactly 12 grams, like 12.0000 grams of carbon-12, I better not go too far because then the electrons will start to come into play. Here, we'll go there. Okay, actually, we'll go there. Then we don't have to worry about electrons, right? Because they're going to be in the tail here. They're so light. Okay, so there it is. If you count these very carefully, you will find that there are 6.02 times 10 to the 23 atoms of carbon in there. And we define this number as Avogadro's number. Who predicted that the same volume of gas at the same temperature and pressure would have the same number of particles in it regardless of the type of gas, which often causes people problems. But what they don't realize is that if you're talking about gases, the volume taken up by the atoms is like so small compared to the volume taken up by the gas that even if you're using big or small atoms in there, they take up such an infinitesimally small amount of space. That's what is more important is the behavior of them, how they're moving in there. It's actually what's going to dictate how much space they take up at a given temperature and pressure. Okay, so the size of the particles doesn't matter. Okay, so there it is. So what can we do with this? Well, we can say this, right? So we know there's 6p and 6n, and we know that the mass of protons is roughly, not exactly, but roughly equal to the mass of protons. So then we could say that in here, okay, in here, in 12 grams, if we have 12 grams here, we have 12 particles. So we could say then, well, we must have 6.02 times 10 to the 23 times 6 protons and 6.02 times 10 to the 23 times 6 neutrons, right? That's how many protons and neutrons we have. Does that make sense? Or another way to look at it is, right, because that adds up to 12, we could say then that, well, 1/12, right? 1/12 of the mass of this should be equal to then 1 Avogadro's number of protons or neutrons. That makes sense. So then we can define the mass of a proton or a neutron as being, again, 1/12 of a gram. So in other words, IOW, 1/12 of 12 grams is equal to the mass of 1 proton or 1 neutron. And now you can walk around the periodic table and you can figure out in terms of grams, right, how much 1 Avogadro's number of any given element would be. So for example, if we look at hydrogen, we know hydrogen is just made of 1 proton with a little electron around there. Well, if we have 1 Avogadro's number, or 1 mole, 1 Avogadro's number of hydrogen atoms, right? How much is that going to weigh? Well, it's going to weigh 1/12 of 12 grams, or 1 gram. If we go to helium, well, now there's 2p and 2n, so now we have 4/12 of 12 grams, or 4 grams. Okay, etc. So that's where you know the mole comes from. We call 1 mole kind of like 1 dozen. 1 mole equals just 6.02 times 10 to the 23 of really anything, but mainly we're going to talk about molecules and atoms. Molecules or atoms. And I think we'll leave it there for now.